Good morning. Back in 1998, Anita and I entered the Salvation Army's training college in London to become Salvation Army officers. Our sessional name was Forward 2000, a name used throughout the Salvation Army world for sessions entering college that year. At first glance, this name suggests two things: movement towards a fixed point in time, i.e. the year 2000, and the concept of not staying still, of movement, of progression, if you like. Well, I want us to look at this phrase just for a moment, because I think with a little tweaking, we can turn it into something quite profound for today. On my TV remote, I have this symbol to indicate fast forward, and this one to indicate play or forward at normal speed. It's also a mathematical symbol used in equations, meaning more than or greater than. The number on the right could be the year 2000, or it could be this year, it could be 2020. It could be my name, it could be your name for that matter. But the important bit is what goes on the left that makes up the equation. And as a Christian, I believe that should be God. So God is greater than, he is more than, he is bigger than. Let's think about that for a moment. God is more than enough for me. God is more than all of my problems. God is more than I could ever ask or imagine. God is more than able. He is more than able to accomplish what concerns me today. And that's the title for our first song this morning. Let's sing together just now.
Accomplish what concerns me today.
We can't do it, but he is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or imagine, according to the power that works within us. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now, I may feel fearful of falling away or failing to reach the target, of letting my family down or faltering on the Christian walk, not able to overcome temptation or able to carry on. But the Lord says this, I am able. I will walk with you. I will be your strength when you're weak. I will give you my wisdom to lead, to fill you with my love when you're empty, to give you my courage when you're attacked by evil. My victory will be yours, for my promises never fail. Trust me and see. General Albert Osborne served as the international leader of the Salvation Army from 1946 to 1954. Now, way back in 1908, he was a captain at Lowestoft No. 2 Corps. And throughout the long and cold winter months of the year, there would be few visitors to the Corps, and attendance to Sunday worship obviously would be much smaller. Well, this was a sign of a discouragement, both to himself and to the lieutenant who was second in command. One morning during prayers, the lieutenant prayed, "Give us, O Lord, faith for greater things." And that phrase led Albert Osborne to write this song, which says, "What a work the Lord has done by his saving grace. Let us praise him, everyone, in his holy place. He has saved us gloriously. Let us onward faithfully. Yet he promised we would see even greater things." Then he goes on to say, "Sanctify thy name, O Lord, by thy people here. For the altar of the sword, save us from our fear. When the battle rages fast, help us in the fiery blast. Let us not be overcast. Prove thy greater things." And the third verse says, "Every comrade, Lord, we pray, thou wilt richly bless. Lead us forth into the fray, one in holiness, one in faith and harmony, one in perfect charity. Then we know that we shall see even greater things." And the chorus, which I'm sure you know, says, "Greater things, greater things. Give us faith, O Lord, we pray. Faith for greater things." Let's pray. Dear Lord, times are really hard right now, and life at times seems confusing or somewhat difficult. I don't know what to do, and so I ask that you bestow upon me wisdom. I don't want to lean on my own understanding, because it's let me down so many times in the past. But I do need to hear your voice. So give me the discernment to hear your voice and your voice alone. Speak to me in the way that you know I will hear you best. I also pray for your will, Lord. I give you the praise and the glory in all of my circumstances, because I know that I'm exactly where you want me to be. I know it's to teach me something or to help me to grow. So no matter what, Lord, I just trust you and I ask you to show me what is best for all of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence. till you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Reading this morning is just one verse from the book of Jude. It's Jude 24, better known as the doxology, and Anita's going to read that to us, and then we're going to listen to it a second time in a slightly different format. So that's Jude verse 24.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Now,
that's the present.
Unto him,
that's the person.
That is able,
that's his power.
To keep you,
that's his protection.
From falling,
that's to make you perfect.
And to present you faultless,
that's to make you pure.
Before the presence of his glory,
that's his prestige.
With exceeding joy,
that's our pleasure.
In a Superman episode, my favorite show growing up was Superman. I love the TV programs and I love the movies. In one of the episodes, a building is on fire. The Man of Steel hears the cry for help and he enters the building with his supersonic power and ability and speed, and he grabs the man who was in danger of being engulfed in the flames, and lifted him up, flew him out of the burning building. But he kept flying up higher and higher and higher and higher. Well, the man was afraid when he was in the fire. Now he's really scared, because there he's way above the earth, and he's terrified of what would happen if Superman dropped him. Superman, seeing his fear, said, "What makes you think that if I delivered you from the fire, I would drop you on my way up out of the fire?" If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you've been delivered from the fire. You've been given the gift of eternal life. But sometimes, on the way up, when things get scary, we are afraid he'll drop us. But what makes you and me think that the God of the universe and his magnificent Savior, who had the ability by his own resurrection to lift us out of the fire, would drop us as we make our way north to glory? I want to say one simple phrase to me, I'm talking to me too, and to you, and to us, that our God is more than enough. I know we're facing a huge crisis of health, a huge crisis of economics, personal crisis of, you know, depression and anxiety, frustration and fear, family crisis, been locked up too long, too tight, educational crisis. Will school open? When will they open? Will it be live? Will it be on video? How will we, you know, it's all over the place. The leaders are confused. We're confused. Confusion is confused, okay? But I would like to suggest to you from a very famous passage of scripture, you can quote it, that your God and my God, our God, is more than enough. I want to take your attention to Psalm 23. I know you know it, but walk with me through it one more time. David, the author of this psalm, summarizes the psalm in verse 1. Verses 2 through 6 is merely the exposition of verse 1. If you get verse 1, you really have the whole psalm. He just breaks it down in 2 through 6. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Translation, he's more than enough.
Now, this word suggests a sense of urgency. Something's got to take place immediately. But you know, the word "now" is special all by itself. It's found many times in the Word of God. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1. "Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth." 1 John 3, verse 2. "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." And Psalm 119:67 says, "Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now have I kept thy word." John 13:7, Jesus answered and said unto him, "What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter." And John 16:12, "I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now." The word "now" is showing some urgency. But urgency of what? Well, let's keep looking at the text for a moment. Unto him. Well, Jude's talking about Jesus, isn't he? That's who him is. Him. The one that existed before a when or where. Him. The one that's co-created the universe. Him. The one that's took a ball of helium and hydrogen and placed it in the sky. Him, the one that's sat on a great throne in glory. Him, the one that's Mary's little baby. Him, the one that taught like a scholar at the age of 12.
him, the one that was baptized by his cousin at the age of 30. Him, the one that walked this earth for 33 and a half years. Him, the one that gave his all for us. But let's make it a little more personal. Because you know, he's my bread when I'm hungry. He's my water when I'm thirsty. He's my friend when I'm friendless. He's my doctor when I'm sick. He's my lawyer when I'm in trouble. He's my bridge over troubled waters. We're talking about Jesus, aren't we? But what about Jesus? The text goes on by saying, that is. And in Hebrews 13:8, it implies that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We believe that, don't we, to be true. We need to understand, back in the day that Jesus walked this earth, he was able to perform some miraculous miracles. Now, if you don't believe me, have a look at your Bible and see what he did back then. He did all sorts of incredible things. He turned a pitcher of water into some priceless wine, some beautiful wine back then. He fed over 5,000 people with a couple of fish and some bread, five pieces of bread, back then. He healed men of a deadly disease called leprosy, back then. He defied the powers of nature. He stopped a fierce storm by saying, peace, be still, back then. He turned a cemetery dwelling maniac into a travelling evangelist, back then. He opened blinded eyes, back then. He fixed twisted tongues, back then. He stopped deaf ears, back then. He did all of that back then. But keep in mind, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the text says, unto him that is able, which tells me that all that he did back then, that today he's still able to do all of that. Whatever you need today, he's still able. He's still able to perform some mighty miracle in your life. He's still able to take an insufficient amount and turn it into an abundance. He's still able to heal all matter of diseases. He's still able to tell the storms of life, peace, be still. He's still able to save from the guttermost to the uttermost. And you know, he's still able to open closed eyes, closed minds, closed hearts. He's able still to do all of these things. Whatever you need him for today, I advise you to turn it over to Jesus, because you know, he's still able to make everything all right. According to the text, he's able to do four things. He's able to protect us. He's able to preserve us. He's able to make us pure. And he's able to make us perfect. And you know, the end result of all of that is exceeding joy. It's translated from the Greek, you know, as exaltation. And I don't know about you today, but I'm going to praise God. I'm going to praise him. I'm going to lift him up. I'm going to bless his name. I told you, he's the same today. He'll be the same tomorrow. But I just have to thank him for what he's done already. And as I think about how good God has been to me, I can't help but praise the Lord. It seems fitting that we continue now with the song 10,000 Reasons. Now, you might have 10,000 reasons in your heart to sing. I hope you have more than that. Although, quite frankly, I'd probably lose count even before I get to triple digits. But we have so much to thank God for. Let's keep believing, because God wants to do even greater things in our lives. So let's sing this song together. And then to finish our worship, there's going to be a sung version of Jude 24. To conclude our time together this week. May God bless you in all that you do for him. Amen. Amen.
sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Sing your song.
Bless the Lord.
Default, I have to love Charles Wesley. And you know, one reason I love him, he's on his deathbed, age 81, and he couldn't stop singing. He couldn't stop writing these amazing hymns of praise. And he's so weak in that moment, he had to have this written down for him, just one verse long, his last ever hymn. And it said this: in age and feebleness extreme, who shall a helpless worm redeem? Jesus, my only strength thou art, strength of my failing flesh and heart. Oh, could I catch one smile from thee and drop into eternity? Isn't that wonderful? You hear the love for Christ in those lyrics. His desire to know him and be with him. Oh, Jesus, on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come.
Oh,
Jesus Christ, our